Hello students, welcome to this lecture on compressible flow. Now in previous lecture we have seen about the concepts of how the properties like velocity and pressure depend upon the cross-sectional area of a duct. So we have seen by decreasing the cross-sectional area, the velocity can be increased, but that is up to a certain limit, and that limit value is the sonic condition. Okay, that means we can reduce the cross-sectional area till the point when the Mach number becomes equal to 1. So if we want to have further more increase in velocity, that is the velocity more than the velocity of the sound or supersonic velocity of flow, then the area must be increased. So these things we have seen by looking at those equations of relation between area, pressure and velocity in terms of Mach number. Okay, now in this lecture we will see a few more concepts related to compressible flow. So let us start. Now we'll see about stagnation properties, like stagnation pressure, enthalpy, temperature, density. So we will look at the stagnation pressure first. Now these stagnation properties are considered in stagnation condition. That means you can imagine a situation where a fluid is coming with certain properties. It is flowing with certain properties at state 1, velocity V1, pressure P1, density and also temperature. Then this flow is brought to rest. You can imagine the flow is flowing like this through a smaller area, then suddenly it is expanded to a larger area. So by some means it is made to come into a state of rest, okay, stagnant condition. Then the properties measured are generally referred to the stagnation properties. But depending upon the process that we make the flow to be stagnant, the corresponding properties are defined. Now when it is brought to rest, the velocity becomes zero. The new properties, let these new properties are with designated as 0.2, P2, Rho2 and T2. So let us define the first property, that is stagnation pressure. Now stagnation pressure is defined that when the fluid is completely brought to rest isentropically. So it is the pressure measured when this flowing fluid is brought to rest by isentropic process. So this word is most important in the definition. If we don't consider this word, then the pressure that we are measuring here is not the stagnation pressure, that will be less than the stagnation pressure. Okay, that means we can have the maximum pressure or the highest pressure only when we make the process isentropic process. Otherwise we will not get that maximum pressure, we will not achieve that theoretical maximum pressure. Okay, so that is the concept. So therefore, while defining stagnation pressure, this isentropic word is important in the definition, and that we will see in the next part why it is important that we have to consider isentropic process. Now this is the Bernoulli's equation, a general energy equation. This is the total energy at state 1 is equal to total energy at state 2 plus losses. Okay, now these losses are due to the internal friction because of the viscosity that we have considered in this equation. So this equation is written considering the correlate this situation to a water turbine where we have pressure energy and kinetic energy. If it is horizontal, then we are not considering the potential head, Z1 equal to Z2. So you can correlate this energy equation to the to a case of application like water turbine where temperature effects are not considered. Okay, now so that is why we have written this equation. Now for reversible adiabatic process, this isentropic process, this HF will be zero. So we are assuming the process to be adiabatic, therefore we are not considering the heat also here. There is no heat transfer. Okay, and the process, if we assume reversible, that means we are neglecting those internal friction due to viscosity. In that case, there will not be any losses. This HF is zero, right? Now we have to consider the process reversible adiabatic or isentropic. If not, then HF will be there. HF will not be equal to zero. So if HF is present, you can see P2 by rho 2. Now this is the pressure P2 at this state. Okay, and this pressure head will be lower than this. It will be lower than this value. You can understand, it will be lower than this value if we have HF. Okay, if we have HF there. So if we eliminate this HF, then this will be equal to this, and that means all this energy at state 1 will be converted into pressure energy. If there is any losses, some part of this energy gets converted into losses, which we don't want. So therefore, that is why we consider that we think that the process has to be isentropic process. That means without any frictions. That means reversible process, ideal process. Then only we will get maximum, we will achieve the maximum pressure when fluid is brought to rest. And that is the concept that why we define the stagnation pressure as, you know, pressure measured when fluid is brought to rest isentropically. Fine. So to continue with this equation, now this P2 is now replaced as P0. So from now, P0 refers to stagnation condition. So P0 by rho 2 equal to P1 by rho 1 plus V1 square by 2. So this is the stagnation pressure, this is stagnation head, this is the static head, okay, and this is the dynamic head. Similarly, the next property is stagnation property, stagnation enthalpy. So stagnation enthalpy, you can see H2 here, H2 itself we will later call it as a stagnation enthalpy. So you can say the definition, you can see here, it is the enthalpy of fluid obtained when fluid is brought to rest by adiabatic process. Now I would like to tell you here that while defining stagnation pressure, we have considered isentropic, but while defining enthalpy, that is stagnation enthalpy, we are only considering adiabatic process. That means we are removing this part, reversible part. What is the meaning? We are allowing certain frictions to happen. Okay, that means to define stagnation enthalpy, the process need not be isentropic, only adiabatic is fine. Okay, and why we are considering adiabatic? Because the duct has to be insulated. You take an example of a steam turbine. Okay, so in steam turbine, that everything, the turbine has to be insulated. Okay, turbine along with the nozzle has to be insulated, otherwise enthalpy will be lost to the surrounding. So therefore we have to consider adiabatic. Okay, now I will explain this concept, but let us see this equation, energy balance equation. Now you see, again here we are considering the internal energy. So this is the energy balance, this is the total energy at state 1. So you can imagine now this as a steam is coming here and steam is brought to rest state. So that situation, you can imagine this, you can correlate this with the application of steam turbine. So in case of steam turbines, temperature is important factor. Temperature means internal energy, it directly indicates internal energy. Okay, so internal energy is a function of temperature. Okay, that is why we are considering internal energy in the energy balance equation. Okay, because there should not be confusion, because here we have not considered internal energy, because this equation more or less correlates to the situation of a water turbine. This equation correlates to a situation of a steam turbine. Okay, so internal energy U1 plus P1 by rho 1, and also we are talking about enthalpy, so obviously internal energy we have to consider. Okay, next, so U1 plus P1 by rho 1 plus V1 square by 2, total energy at state 1. This is the total energy at state 2. So definitely V2 will be 0. So V2 will be 0. Here also V2 will be 0. That you have to think, you have to consider. Okay. Now, so this we can write H1 plus P1 by rho 1. We can replace it by U1 plus P1 by rho 1. We can replace by H1, because H equal to U plus PV. That is the mathematical definition of enthalpy, defined in thermodynamics. Okay, the basic concepts of thermodynamics, because 1 by rho 1 is a specific volume. Okay, so therefore it is H1 plus V1 square by 2 equal to the U2 plus P2 by rho 2, and this is written as H0, because it is H2, we have taken that as the stagnation enthalpy with zero designation. So this is how it is defined. Now important thing is, I would like to tell that why it is adiabatic process. Because you see, even if friction is present, that means if we allow the friction to happen, okay, then what will happen? Because of the friction, there will be a rise in the temperature. So there will be a rise in the temperature. So this rise in the temperature, it will directly affect the internal energy. So it will affect the internal energy, U1 and U2. But U1 is there in this side also and in this also. So that rise in temperature or the presence of friction does not affect the overall equation. It is ultimately same only, because U1 minus U2 is what we get ultimately. Okay, because friction will be present here and here also. So during the process, friction will be present. So it will not affect du. Okay, it will not affect du. So that is why we are assuming that we are allowing that friction process. So therefore we are considering only adiabatic, not isentropic. Okay, So some important relations we will see. Now you see dh can be expressed as cp dt. So integration of dh, integration of cp dt, or h we can write cpt plus some constant, right? So also h naught equal to h1 plus v1 square by 2. So this equation we have seen from here. Substituting for h, now you see we have this h in terms of cpt plus constant. We can substitute here in this equation for corresponding notations. Cpt0, now this is for 0 means it is cpt0 equal to cpt for h1, it is cpt, either you write h1 or simply h, it doesn't matter, okay, plus v1 square by 2, so it is v square by 2. You can see the k will, it's a constant, it will cancel from both the sides. Now t0 by t, 1 plus v square by 2 cp t. Also these are certain standard relations between the specific weights. Difference in specific weights, you can write in terms of r, that is gas constant. The ratio of specific heat is defined as gamma, okay. So therefore cp can be expressed in terms of gamma and r. These are some relations. Now this value of cp in terms of gamma and r is substituted here, and we will get relation between temperature, that is the stagnation temperature, t0 by t equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 v square by 2 gamma rt. Now you see this gamma rt, this gamma rt we can replace by a square, because a is equals to root of gamma rt, that is the velocity of sound, okay. So we will get t0 by t equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 m a square. This is the Mach number. Now how this Mach number is coming? Because we have replaced gamma rt by a square, so v square by a square we can write m square or MA square, Mach number. MA means Mach number, okay. Also from adiabatic process, for adiabatic process we can write the relation between pressure and temperature from basic thermodynamic concepts. P0 by P equal to T0 by T raised to gamma by gamma minus 1. This is a, these are the relations. So we can replace this T0 by T here, and we will get relation between stagnation pressure in terms of Mach number, okay. So also we can write this density rho naught by rho in terms of temperature. Again this relation we have, therefore rho naught by rho we can write like this. So these are the relations of you can say stagnation properties with the Mach number. These are important relations, and these are actually plotted by by conducting experiments. These are plotted in a chart, and the chart is referred while doing analysis of compressible flow. So this is these are few concepts that I have explained in this video. In the next video we will see about mass flow rate to converging nozzle, and the concept of choking in nozzle. So thank you for watching this video.